Welcome to another episode of the Tobago House of Assembly's Post-Executive Council Media Briefing. This week, the Chief Secretary Orville London addresses the media.
We're going to be debating the draft TT bill for the self-government of for Tobago. This bill, of course, is the culmination of 4 years of consultations, of conferences throughout Tobago and in Trinidad, where we will have held, I would think, close to 50 meetings, had numerous sessions with interest groups. In fact, you have to say it was in two phases. Phase one was during the time of the People's Partnership Government, and that will have climaxed with a series of meetings between the members of the Forum of Political Parties and the representatives of the central government. Those meetings were aborted shortly before the election, and then the process resumed after the election when we got the commitment from the Prime Minister that once the bills were presented to the Cabinet, the process will continue. We were, of course, instructed by the mandate coming from the convention, at the Signal Hill Convention, and that, of course, would have instructed us to ensure that we came up with a bill which was representative of the views of the majority of people of Tobago. That draft bill, and I want to commend all the members of the committee who would have been involved in the process, members of the Tobago Platform of Truth, members of the People's National Movement, consultants, the members of the Secretariat, and of course, our attorneys, State Counsel Gilbert Peterson and Ms. Ingrid Melville. And they were the ones who would have drafted the bill, which was taken to another convention, this time at the Lowlands Multipurpose Complex, where people had an opportunity to comment. Further amendments were made, and we now have a draft bill. That bill does not represent unanimity. It is impossible to have achieved unanimity among all those groups and sectors and individuals with whom we might have interfaced. And in addition to that, of course, it does not represent necessarily the views of all the members of the forum. Even within the forum itself, there would have been disagreements and they had to have concessions made. And people had to give up some of their strong positions in order to achieve consensus. The second thing I want to indicate is that we have removed the whip from all the persons who will speak tomorrow. So persons who speak tomorrow will have the authority to speak their mind, if you want to put it like that, and give their personal opinion, because we believe that this is something that is so critical that we should give an opportunity for all views to be aired. Of course, most of those persons will be speaking tomorrow would have had their input, so that to a certain extent the bill will represent their views. But if their views differ from one another, then that is no problem, because we feel that the whip should be removed for this particular event. So that is the situation tomorrow, and we're hoping that once the bill is approved by the House, it will go to the Cabinet Secretariat to be taken to Cabinet, and of course the process will continue from there. This is the Tobago position, and we are very well aware that this is treating with the relationship between Tobago and Trinidad. So there must be a conversation between among the people of the country. And therefore, we expect that over the next couple of months, this conversation would be initiated, and that it will be a conversation where persons attempt to understand each other's perspective, and a conversation that is, you know, conducted in an environment of mutual concern, and a conversation where each side is going to try to see the other's point of view, and hopefully we come to the kind of consensus that will allow us to at least end successfully this phase of a very, very long journey. So that is the present position. As you are aware, Tobago would have had its own challenges. The funding in Tobago is much less than it was last year, but the percentage is more or less the same. So we have said, and I want to reiterate, that we think that we were treated with a degree of equity and sensitivity, and we should not complain too much about that. However, we have to manage the resources, and we have been involved in a series of meetings. In fact, I've just come from one today. We started early this morning looking at the allocation and trying to find ways and means by which we can utilize it as effectively as possible. And I think basically we have the wherewithal to manage the resources. And in that context, I am fairly confident that we will be able to deliver to the people of Tobago, maybe not as much as we would have liked, but deliver in a manner that the pain would not be as great as many people envisage it to be. So that the secretary would only be speaking for 10 minutes because that's the time allocated for a statement. But in the 10 minutes, hopefully be able to highlight the philosophy behind the budget activities and our response to the allocation, speak to some of those projects and programs which we commit to deliver regardless of our constraints, and of course indicate and emphasize the role that the people of Tobago should be playing in ensuring that we're able to get as much out of our lessened allocations as possible. And I just want to reiterate what I've been saying all the time, that this is a challenge, but it does provide us with an opportunity to really show our mettle and to be in a position where we can deliver more with less. And that is not just a platitude. That is something I feel that we are capable of doing. Last Friday, the National Tourism Standing Committee would have met in Tobago. And at that meeting, which was held at the Magdalena Grand Hotel, we were able to treat primarily with Tobago matters. The Tourism Standing Committee comprises representatives of the cabinet, headed by the Prime Minister, including the Secretary of Tourism, the Secretary of Planning, the Minister of Tourism, the Minister of Planning, Minister of Foreign Affairs, the Minister of Culture, and of course the Minister Webster Roy from the Office of the Prime Minister. And then, of course, from the Tobago House of Assembly, the Secretary of Tourism, myself, their Chief Administrator, representatives of TDC, etc. And we were able to treat with a number of issues. One of the more important issues which we treated was the issue of Air Caribbean. And a commitment was made that the new board of Caribbean Airline will meet with the Tobago House of Assembly within the next 2 weeks. That board, I think, is going to be confirmed tomorrow. And one of its first activities will involve a meeting with the Tobago House of Assembly. And we are going to be preparing for the minister responsible for Caribbean Airlines a list of the issues over which we have had concern for very many years, and of course, recommendations. Among our recommendations would be that we believe that Caribbean Airlines as the airline, a national airline, should be focused on primarily on national issues, or first and foremost on national issues. And therefore, as a national carrier, the focus has to be on the air bridge, and priority has to be given to Tobago and the needs of Tobago. So with respect to the air bridge, there has to be more predictability, there has to be more flights, and of course, certain requests that have been made of Air Caribbean, Caribbean Airlines over the years, and which have been more or less ignored. For example, a connection to Barbados to allow us to be able to link with Barbados and be able to have some benefits from the international carriers that come to Barbados. The possibility of one of the, I think it's 10 or 11 flights coming out of Canada, that one of them, at least one of them should also come to Tobago. The question of the Scandinavian market, this is a very lucrative market for Tobago, and we had approached Caribbean Airlines after we had lost the flight which brought the Apollo tourists to Tobago a couple of years ago. Caribbean Airlines had not responded positively, and it would have been a flight that basically there was a no-lose situation as far as I was concerned, because the flight was going to be about 90%. It's a charter, over 90% load factor for every flight, and yet we were not able to convince Caribbean Airlines. So I am hopeful that with this new dispensation, we will be in a position to get a more favorable response from them, because I think Caribbean Airlines has a critical role to play, not only in ensuring predictable and dignified travel between the two islands, but also in ensuring that they help to facilitate the expansion of the tourism sector. Now, as you all are aware, last year we would have started Tobago Day. We moved and we changed from Assembly Day to Tobago Day, and there were reasons for this, and I think very good reasons. And among them, of course, is the fact that it is a day when we want to celebrate our Tobago-ness and be able to heighten people's appreciation for the island and its culture and its heritage. And therefore, we went a little further this year, and we set up a committee comprising representatives of all the divisions to come up with a proposal that would, to a certain extent, reflect the objectives of having a Tobago Day in the first place. And the activities that have been recommended and accepted earlier today by the Executive Council would span 1 week. I'm going to make a schedule of events available to you, but I just want to give you an idea of some of the activities. Between Sunday the 27th of November and Sunday the 4th of December, we're going to ask religious organizations to offer special prayers on behalf of Tobago and the Tobago House of Assembly. And then Monday the 28th, there's going to be a library program, libraries across Tobago. Throughout the week, there's going to be the Tobago Art Collection is going to be open for viewing at the Shore Park Complex. That will run from the Monday right through until the Friday. And then there'll be a customer appreciation week. All the divisions of the Tobago House of Assembly are going to be geared towards customer appreciation, where people will come in, and of course the focus would be on ensuring that people get the best customer service. And of course the idea is that will spill over into the rest of the year, where people, you know, appreciate the need to give the best customer service possible. On Monday the 28th of November from 5 to 7, there'll be a praise and worship event at the Shore Park Cultural Complex. And then on Tuesday, there'll be a cultural exposition for schools and youth organizations, and that will be between 9:30 and 12. And we're hoping to get anything like between 1,500 and 2,000 young people at that venue for that particular activity. On Wednesday the 30th, there will be a primary schools quiz. And the whole idea behind the quiz is not just to have people involved in competition, but also to do it in such a way that the information, the dissemination of the information, is effective and widespread. Many times, you know, you have these quizzes and you just get the bright persons getting involved, and maybe only five or so people are influenced. But we're hoping to send the information to the school so that the information could be disseminated to all the students. And we're hoping that the quiz could be broadcast so that the information could be disseminated. And then on Thursday, a youth plenary at the Tobago House of Assembly Chamber from 1:30 to 4. And we're hoping to have a Tobago Day football tournament, maybe interdivisional, on that afternoon at 4. And on Friday, there's a new event that you're going to hear more about. It's a Tobago Wonders Challenge, where we're going to have teams going throughout Tobago, and the challenge is going to take them to various historical sites and sites of interest throughout Tobago. And that's on Friday from 9 a.m. to 5 p.m. They're very attractive prices. And then at 10 a.m., there is going to be a business expo at the Milford Road Esplanade, a street procession from 4 to 5, climaxing with a cultural show at the same Esplanade from 5:30. We want to have some time capsules, which will be opened on the 50th anniversary of the Tobago House of Assembly in 2030 in Southwest, East, and North Tobago. We want to do a Tobago Day Cycling Classic around the loop from Milford Road, around Milford Road, Esplanade to Shaw Park and back. And then at 6 p.m. on Saturday, we have the regular tree lighting ceremony at the Botanic Station. There'll also be a tree lighting ceremony at the Louisdon Nursery on Saturday the 10th, both at 6 p.m. But the Tobago Day celebrations would climax with the Tobago Day Awards Sunday the 4th of December at the Shaw Park Complex. I just want to remind all of us that nomination forms are available, and the deadline for nominations is 11th of November 2016. There are going to be a number of different categories. You have the Tobago Medal of Honor, gold, silver, and bronze. And you're also going to have the Chief Secretary's Award. The difference is that the Chief Secretary's Award will be for activities within the calendar year, exemplary, outstanding achievements during the particular year. The Medal of Honor, gold, silver, and bronze will be for outstanding, very outstanding achievements, and achievements over a long period and so on. There are different categories, and the details are available on the form. This year, we're also going to launch the Calypso Rose and the Mighty Shadow Awards in Culture. The Calypso Rose Awards will be for Calypso, and Mighty Shadow Award will be in the Performing Arts. And again, organizations would be expected to make recommendations or make nominations, and we have a very transparent process for selection. There'll be a prize of $30,000 to the winner in each category, and this is an annual award to be given to individuals, as I said, who are selected, and the money is to be used towards whether it's improving their repertoire, whether it is in more exposure, whatever, but it is to be used to assist them in furthering their cultural ambitions. So that generally is the situation. I think I am very pleased with the initial response coming out of the committee, and I think that we're going to have a very special day to Tobago, well, Tobago Week celebration this time around. Just before I left the Executive Council, the Secretary of Health and Social Services was quite pleased to pass on the information that the CAT lab activities at the Scarborough General Hospital have been activated. In fact, there were two procedures, he indicated, done today. Two males, one aged 29, one aged 61. Coronary angiograms. And I then spoke to acting CEO, Dr. Duke, and he indicated that what they call interventional procedures are likely to be done on a weekly basis. He did, however, indicate that they're going to start with the less complicated procedures, and then as they develop and so on, they're going to have more complicated procedures. But I think it's a landmark event to actually have an interventional procedure done in Tobago with the commitment or the recognition that we'll be able to take it to another level somewhere down the road, and that procedures might be done as often as once a week. So this does show that we have the capacity, we have the equipment and so on, and I think it can only get better from here. And finally, I've been asked to indicate that the Business Outlook Conference, the annual Business Outlook Conference, is going to take place on the 8th of November at Magdalena Grand, starting at 8:30, with the Youth Empowerment Forum, guided for the Pigeon Point Heritage Park, on Friday, November the 11th. I think this has received a lot of public exposure, and I expect that more information will become available as we go along.
Just a couple questions. With regards to speaking particularly to the budget, and you already alluded or hinted to a couple challenges in the upcoming year. Can you indicate, if any, or probably give a pre-warning as to some of the areas that we can expect cutbacks or anything of that regard?
Well, basically, there are certain projects which will have to be rescheduled. That is one of the things that we're looking at today. We're looking at today what are the projects that we can reschedule and the projects that we can scale down. That exercise has not yet been completed. What I can tell you is that we have obviously committed to doing all the ongoing projects to complete, make sure that the ongoing projects are not stopped. The projects having to do, for example, the project having to do with human resource development, this is one project that we know that we're not going to stop. There are some infrastructural projects in the Division of Infrastructure and Public Utilities with which we have to treat. There are things like the abattoir, which has to be done, the health facility at Roxborough. All of those projects, you know, we believe have to be dealt with, so that when the secretary makes his statement tomorrow, by that time we will have finalized some of the must-do projects, I call them, and I think he will give you a little bit more detail on them. But we're dealing one with projects that are ongoing and therefore have to be completed, and projects that have a significant impact on the development of the communities, a development of people, projects that if they are not done are likely to have a serious impact on the quality of life of people. And then, of course, those projects, for example, enterprise assistance, enterprise development funding to assist entrepreneurs and so on, all of those projects we expect to continue to fund them. Some projects in community development, we're looking at those. We also obviously have to ensure that there is funding for the tourism thrust, tourism, the marketing of tourism, not just the upkeep of our tourism resorts and so on, all of those areas where we are going to place emphasis.
Can you speak to the possibility of jobs being lost, if any at all, seeing that we have received a reduced fiscal package?
I would not say at this point in time that we have catered for job loss. Obviously, it is always going to be a challenge. And but we will try as far as possible to minimize any job loss. But of course, you have to be able to balance. But we recognize the challenges, especially in a Tobago environment where the alternatives are not very many. So we will only do that if we do have a choice. But the credibility of the expenditure has to be maintained. You can't employ people except you have work for them to do and you have money to pay them. But we're going to try to manage that situation as best as we could.
All right. With regards to the surge waves that would have rocked some of the businesses on the West End, I know that yourself and the tourism secretary would have visited various businesses. Could you, if possible, give me an update on possibly the situation with those businesses and the assembly's involvement, if any, to compensate or assist the businesses in their recovery?
Well, from the perspective of assist, and I can't speak with any great degree of certainty as to what has happened within those business places, but I know from the perspective of assist that immediately after the event, TEMA, URP, maybe CPEP, I'm not certain, and I would think some units from infrastructure would have assisted in the cleanup process. Now, based on what I saw when I went to Pigeon Point, I don't think that the damage was... It was more inconvenience rather than damage as such, a lot of sand, etc. And as one of the business owners indicated, that it is not something that is unique. They have these challenges maybe twice a year. I think this time it was more serious, and therefore it was a matter of getting rid of sand and so on, etc. And I think that the boat owners heeded the warnings, and most of them brought their vessels out of danger. So I'm not aware of any significant damage. We have assisted in the past where vessels have sustained damage through, you know, adverse weather condition, but I am not aware. It will only come to me after the Division of Agriculture, Marine Affairs, Market and the Environment would have made the evaluation. That's the only time it comes to me, but I haven't heard anything and I haven't seen anything. You all would be in a better position to tell me, because I'm certain that if they had challenge, they come to you before they come to me. So, but I think all in all, we were very fortunate from that particular aspect, that I don't think any significant damage was felt.
Thank you for staying with us for the Tobago House of Assembly's post-executive council media briefing for the week ending October 29th, 2016.